I'd like to speak about a very powerful lesson in Tefillah that we can learn in Parshat Shoftim from the Inyan of the Ari Miklat. So the Inyan of the Ari Miklat, okay, is that Klal Yisrael had to designate six cities, three in Eiver HaYarden HaMizrachi, which is known as the Transjordan, and three in Eretz Yisrael proper, to be used in case somebody killed somebody accidentally. Okay, just to read the lesson of the Torah, the following scenario could happen, that Asher Yavod Re'ehu Be'yar Lachtov Itzim, person going into the forest and he goes to chop down trees. And what happens is that his axe, he takes his axe and he swings it at the tree, and the blade becomes dislodged from the wood. Okay, just to read, V'nidchaya doba garzen l'chrota eitz, v'nashal habarzel mera eitz, umatsa et re'ehu. It finds your friend, okay, meaning accidentally it finds the neck, the head of your friend, and you accidentally murder your friend. So what does that person have to do? Hu yanus elachad ha'arim ha'ela v'chai. He now has to escape into one of these six cities that have been designated as the Arei Miklat, okay, a place for a leklo, to absorb a person who had accidentally murdered. And he has to stay there. Why? So the Torah says, v'chai. What does that mean? It means that if there's a relative of the deceased who wants to avenge the blood of his deceased relative, he can't now come after you because you accidentally murdered his relative. As long as you're in that place of refuge in the Arei Miklat, but he cannot kill you. Okay, how long does a person who accidentally murders have to stay there? So he can end up staying there for many, many years. He's now there. The Torah goes on to describe he has to stay there to get protection from the Goel Adam until the death of the Kohen Gadol. Okay, so imagine the following scenario. Imagine, okay, the person has been there for years. He's been separated from his family, his community, his shevet, and he's dying to get out of there, okay? And he's davening, Kadosh Baruch Hu, get me out of there, okay? Tefillah from the depth of his heart, he's so lonely, he's desperate to get out of there. And, you know, what could happen if he's davening to get out of there so sincerely, his tefillahs could be answered? And what would that mean? That means that he's davening for the death of the Kohen Gadol. Right, but imagine, okay, the rest of Klal Yisrael wants the Kohen Gadol. The rest of the Klal Yisrael is benefiting from the tahara that they are able to reach through the avoda of the Kohen Gadol, okay, and they need him as their leader, and everybody else wants the Kohen Gadol alive, and this one accidental murderer might be davening for the death of the Kohen Gadol, and his tefillahs could be answered. Right? And so what happens? The Gemara tells us that the mothers, okay, of the Kohanim, okay, and I'll just read to you the source of this, is Masechet Makot, the Imotean shel Kohanim sapkot lehem michya ukesut. They would come traveling around to the Arei Miklat, feeding and clothing these accidental murderers in order so that the accidental murderers would feel like, how could I daven? This woman is taking care of me. How could I daven that her son should die? In order so that they shouldn't daven for the death of their son, they would now go wandering around to these cities feeding and clothing the murderers, right? It's so hard to understand, okay? But yet, it's a powerful lesson in tefillah to understand that when tefillah comes from the depth of a person's heart, when the person really feels like, Kadosh Baruch Hu, okay, I'm desperate, please save me, right? That's how we can understand karov karov. Hashem l'chol karav, l'chol asher yikru'u be'emes. When somebody be'emes sincerely believes that a Kadosh Baruch Hu is the address, when that tefillah is so sincere, right, it has such a koach that it can counteract what everybody else wants. Everybody else wants the Kohen Gadol to be alive, and this one person who's davening, please get me out of here, his sincere tefillahs could be answered. There's another example we can give of this. Okay, and this is an example I saw in the lesson of the Rechatzka Levenstein. Rechatzka Levenstein was a mashgiach in the Mir in Shanghai. He was a mashgiach in Panovich, and he quotes the Saba Mikelmer, Simcha Zisel, in saying the following example about the power of tefillah. Okay, imagine the following situation. Okay, imagine Klal Yisrael is in a time of drought. Okay, I've been living in Eretz Yisrael for 36 years, and we've had many times that a year is declared a year of drought, right? The halacha says that if Rosh Chodesh Kislev comes and we haven't had rain yet, so it's declared a year of drought, and there are additional tefillahs added into davening, and sometimes there are gatherings. I've been at a number of these gatherings of special tefillahs. We have tefillahs of the Tinokot Shel Beit Rabban, right? The sincere tefillahs of the children, and yet, okay, at the same time, the Gemara tells us, okay, that when the Kohen Gadol would come out of the Kodesh Kedoshim, he would daven for many things for the sake of Klal Yisrael, and one of the things he would daven for was, Hashem, don't answer the tefillahs of the Ovri Drachim. right? The people were traveling who were desperate to get home safely. And if it would rain, they would be wet and they'd be, you know, dripping wet and cold and weeks of travel, maybe a month of travel. And they would say, Hashem, don't send rain. We're so cold. Please don't send rain. And they could be davening with such insincerity that the Kohen Gadol had to daven, don't answer their tefillas. And yet, you have can have the rest of Klal Yisrael davening. It's a time of drought, right? And everybody's saying the same Talmata Levracha, and the Kohen Gadol has to daven. Don't listen to the sincere tefillas of the Ovri Drachem. That's the koach of tefila. That's Karov Hashem l'chol karav l'chol ashei kru'u b'emes. That's what we say right before Shmona Esrei, right? When we say Va'onela Amot be'et shavam elav, that Hashem answers His nation be'et shavam elav when they turn to Him with sincere tefila and they plead with Him. That's the koach of tzir tefillah, to the point where the tefillah of the Ovrei Drachem could be answered unless the Kohen Gadol davens to counteract their tefillahs. So I have to share with you an incredible story on the koach of tefillah. Okay, this is a story I saw in a sefer called Shvil HaZahav, written by somebody named Rav Hershkowitz. He has a few beautiful svarim that I have. One called She'ifos, about aspirations to grow in Torah. Another sefer called Asar Nisyonos. And he shares the following incredible story. He says, a story told by a Baal Tshuva who had a group of friends he knew from his days in the army. They had all fought in the Yom Kippur War. And even though he now chose a life of Torah mitzvot, and his friends unfortunately had not yet chosen that lifestyle, they were good friends of his. And every once in a while he'd get together with them. And he invited a group of these friends to come to his home. And he had set the table with some plates and some watermelon, and he excused himself to go into the kitchen to bring out some more food. And while he's in the kitchen, he overhears the following conversation. Okay, they turn to each other, and one of them says, you know, we're in the house of our friend who's dati. The correct thing would be to make a bracha, and when we're eating the food, to honor the way he lives his life. So what do we say, right? And you can imagine how far removed they are, that they don't even know what to say. And one starts to say, well, I think you say bori pre eitz, because watermelons are fruits. And the other one said, no, watermelon doesn't grow on an eitz, it doesn't grow on a tree. I think you say bori pri adama because it comes from the adama. And the third one says, no, I know what the right bracha is. We all have to say shakol niyeh bedvaro. And they turn to him and they say, you know, like, why are you so insistent that that's the bracha? And he shares with them the following story. Okay, he says that in the Yom Kippur War, he was serving in a unit, okay, of tanks, and they were stationed on the border of Sinai, and they were sent on some mission to destroy an Egyptian unit, and it seemed to be a pretty simple mission, and yet something went terribly wrong. And the Egyptian army started to shoot at them and started to hit, were accurate in their target, and they started to destroy their tanks and kill many soldiers. And his commanding officer, okay, of this not religious soldier, turned to his unit and said, does anybody know any of the prayers of the Datiyim? Anybody can teach us, anybody know any tefillot of the Datiyim? Please, we're desperate, we must pray because we're all going to be killed. And there was total silence. Not one soldier knew how to daven, right? I was telling this over to a friend of mine and she actually started to cry. She says, can you imagine? They didn't know what Shema Yisrael was. Right? And then one turned to the other ones and said, I don't know if this would count. It's not, I don't know if it's really a tefillah, but I do remember something from my childhood. I would go visit my grandfather, and every time my grandfather would give me a drink, he would say to me, we have to say thank you to Hashem for the drink. And he would teach me to say Shakol Niyeh Bedvaro. The officer turns to all the soldiers and says, well, that's what we're going to do. That's the only prayer that we know from the Datiyim. That's what we're going to do. Please teach us, what do we say? And he taught everyone in his unit to say, Baruch Atah Hashem Elokeinu Melech HaOlam Shehakol Niyeh Bedvaro. And the officer says, when I motion to you to say this prayer, we all say the prayer together. We scream out this prayer, Shehakol Niyeh Bedvaro, and then we shoot. And that's when they did. That's what they did. The soldier said, the officer said to them, everyone together, Baruch Atah Hashem Elokeinu Melech HaOlam Shehakol Niyeh Bedvaro, and they shot. And with that first shooting, they were able to destroy, okay, the shoot exactly at the gas tank of the tank of the Egyptian army, and they were able to explode the tank and destroy a tank. And again, he turned to them and say, again, Shehakol Niyeh Bedvaro, and they all said the bracha from the depth of their heart, Shehakol Niyeh Bedvaro, and again, okay, they bombed another tank. Okay, and again, another tank, and another tank. And at that point, the Egyptian army withdrew and they won the battle. Right? Can you imagine? So now this you know, soldier who had fought in the army and had experienced this turned to his friend and he says, if Shehakol Niyeh Bedvaro worked to destroy an Egyptian army, then it's not going to work on watermelon? Right? Can you imagine? Okay, so now this Baal Tshuva, okay, is hearing this argument from his friends, and you know, he says to himself, Ribono Shel Olam, can you imagine? You don't turn to the fact, okay, that these men are so far removed from you that they never turn to you. And now they finally turn to you in desperation because they need you, and you don't say, where have you been until now? And you answer the tefillas, okay, the sincere tefillas of these soldiers, right? That's the Rachamim of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Can you imagine? Imagine, but to be able to get to that sincerity of tefillah, right, takes avoda. It takes work to be able to really dig into the depths of a person's heart and really scream out to HaKadosh Baruch Hu when a person's in need, to be able to really have those tefillahs come from the depth of the heart. Gemara tells us, again, this is a Masechet Brachot, that Chasidim Rishonim hayu shoim sha'a achat umitpalalim. Okay, they would first wait and anticipate, and then they would daven. Kadeshi kavnu libam la'avim shabashamayim, in order that they would have the correct kavana when they return to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Okay, so what does that mean? It doesn't mean that they wasted an hour before davening. Okay, it means that they would spend time in trying to remove any foreign thoughts that would distract from their kavana. They would get to the point of knowing exactly I'm standing before HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and I love Hashem, and Hashem loves me, and I have fear of Hashem, and I know that I'm in Hashem's hands, and He's capable of anything that I need. And they would think about the things that they need, and the any yeshuas that they need, and any difficult situations they would need. And then, at that point, when they had the correct kavana, that's when they would daven. Okay, and I don't know how many of us have that time, okay, or that ability to spend so much time preparing for davening, okay, but it's something to think about, okay, even a minute or two. So don't just run in, you know, to shul, okay, you know, Shabbos morning, or don't just open my sitter and start mumbling the words, but to stop for a minute and just say, Dalif ne miata umed, okay, to think about who I'm standing before, Shiviti Hashem negdi tamid, I'm standing before HaKadosh Baruch Hu, okay, and I know that He is the address for everything I need, to perhaps think about things that are going on in your particular life, perhaps your own yeshuas that you might be davening for, somebody who you know needs yeshua. And when you're at the point, okay, and sometimes, you know, it awakens a lot of emotion to realize that HaKadosh Baruch Hu, I'm really in your hands. And at that moment to start davening, well, then maybe that tefillah is really coming from the depths of a person's heart. The Gemara tells us that from the time of the Chorban, Yom Shachara Beit HaMikdash, Ninalu Shari Tefillah, the gates of tefillah have been sealed. Okay, and the Gemara quotes a pasuk in Echa that says, "Gam ki azak vashavea sasam tefilasi." Okay, even if I cry out, I call out to you, and I plead with you, the tefillah has been sealed. Okay, and that's an allusion that since the time of the Chorban, the shari tefillah have been sealed. And yet the Gemara goes on to say that shari dima lo nanalu, but the gates of tears, tefillah, when it's sincere tefillah with tears, that is never going to be sealed. So the Gerei Rebbe asks a great question. He says, if the gates are never sealed, then what do we need gates for, right? What do you need a gate for if it's never closed? It could be continuously opened. And he answers with a very powerful answer. And he says that the gate is necessary to shut out tears that are not sincere. Okay, meaning a person could cry and it doesn't really mean that they believe be'et shavah me'lav, okay, that Hashem answers the tefillahs when you really cry out to Him. When a person has sincere tears of tefillah, those tears wash open the gate towards tefillah. The Sefer Yarot Dvash says that the gematria of Bechi and the gematria of Lev are the same. They're both 32, to tell us, okay, that sincere tears are tears that come as an expression of the heart. So I'd like to end with a story about Rav Aryeh Levine. Okay, if anybody has not read the book about Rav Aryeh Levine, it's Tzaddik in Her Time, I highly recommend you read that book. It's an incredible book. First of all, to see, okay, what an incredible person this was, who worried about all types of people from Klal Yisrael. He would go visit people in prison. He'd go visit people in lepers colonies, people that nobody cared about, everybody forgot about, and he didn't forget about anybody in Klal Yisrael. Okay, and you know, when you read the book about Rebbe Zinkanievsky, okay, who was his granddaughter, you see how much she was like him. That also, all the nebuchs of society ended up by him, right? She learned that from her grandfather. In fact, she used to go with him on Shabbos to some of the places to go visit these people. So there's an incredible story told with him that a recently widowed woman came before him, right, and said, I don't understand, okay, my husband was ill, and I cried perek after perek of Tehillim, I davened, and I cried, and I cried, and I cried, but my tefillahs weren't answered. What happened to all those tears? Were all those tears wasted? And his answer to her was the following. He says, no tear, no tefillah is wasted. We don't always know what those tefillahs work for, but there's no such thing as a tear that is wasted. When you come to Shemayim at 120, you're going to see that HaKadosh Baruch Hu collected every one of your tears. Okay, each tear was like a precious stone to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And you'll see that there were times that there were terrible gzeiras that were looming over Klal Yisrael, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu took one of your tears and washed away the gzeira. Okay, but there's no such thing as a wasted tear. Okay, now obviously this woman cried again when she heard this. Okay, but these weren't tears of desperation; they were tears, okay, of hope. And it says in the book, okay, that a number of months later, this woman came back to Rav Aryeh Levine and says, please tell me that story again. Okay, she felt that what he had said to her then and what she wanted to hear again was such chizuk to remind us, Karov Hashem l'chol, karov l'chol sheikru be'emet, okay, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu takes those tears because the Shari Dimra are never sealed.